Hello, and welcome back to the Camera Rolling Podcast. This is episode 4 of season 2, and I'm your host, Ronnie. For the month of February, I thought I would discuss different romantic movies, and today I'm starting with 27 Dresses. But before I get started, I have a couple of things I want to say first. So first off, if I sound a little weird or a little funny, it's because I'm not feeling 100%. I've had a little bit of congestion around my nose and like ear area, and I know it's not COVID, but it's still, yeah, I'm just having a weird time. Anyway, of course, the other thing is my recent watches. So both movies this week actually happen to be somewhat of historical fiction. The first movie is a 2019 Lifetime movie about the Nellie Bly story. It follows Christina Ricci's character in the late 1800s as she goes undercover to investigate the conditions of an insane asylum. It's very much a Lifetime movie in the sense that I believe it takes a lot of liberties with the actual story. While I'm sure they were trying to tell an interesting and somewhat underrated story, it does have a sense of drama that feels strange. It's simultaneously over and underproduced. Plus, the ending feels so sad, thinking that she just gets to leave because her boyfriend is an important figure who can vouch for her when there's women there who literally can't leave because they just don't know English. But if you're super interested, you can read the actual book 10 Days in a Madhouse by Nellie Bly for the actual story. I don't know. Lifetime movies about real things that happen, whether it be over a book series like I think Flowers in the Attic, or something to do with like true crime, like I think they did one about Jodi Arias, are very weird feeling, but like kind of fun in a weird way. I don't know how to describe it. Anyway, the next movie is Sputnik. It's a 2020 Russian film directed by Igor Abramenko. I don't really know how vowels are pronounced in Russian, so just throwing that out there. Either way, it follows Tatiana, a psychiatrist in 1983 brought in to assess an astronaut who returned from space with an alien life form inside of him. She spends her time both trying to learn more about this life form, but also figure out the secrets her colleagues are keeping from her about this operation. It's actually a really interesting movie with amazing visuals and twists all throughout. I would definitely recommend it if you enjoyed movies in the sci-fi horror genre like Alien. Also, just to note, I love how I always watch in my own free time, like horror movies or scary movies or thrillers, but then when I come on here to talk, it's always like a chick flick. It's called duality. Anyway, let's jump into today's topic, 27 Dresses. So like I said before, for February, I wanted to talk a little bit on and analyze movies that are deemed romantic, and more so in the sense the enemies to lovers trope. Enemies to lovers is a fun trope, but the realities of engaging with opposites attract doesn't always work. Many times the situation is actually toxic or creates conflicts of morality, such as the obvious issues with movies like Purple Hearts. So 27 Dresses is a 2008 rom-com starring Katherine Heigl, James Marsden, Malin Ackerman, and Edward Burns. It was directed by Anne Fletcher and written by Alan Broche McKenna. The story follows Katherine Heigl's character Jane when his sister comes into town and falls for her crush and boss George. At the same time, she's captured the attention of Kevin, a writer for the commitment section of the newspaper. While he writes lovey-dovey articles, he's actually a cynical non-believer of weddings. He decides to write about Jane's sister's wedding, but spends much of his time following Jane as she's been a bridesmaid in 27 weddings, yet still hasn't found love for herself. I think it's interesting that this is considered a rom-com when much of the story has more to do with Jane's growth as a character. We actually don't see a lot of interaction with Kevin for the first half of the movie as well. I think I would put this film more under the category of being a girly film or a chick flick. And I don't really like the term chick flick, but I do feel like this movie isn't that romantic, but it's still girly because they talk about their feelings and it's about weddings and blah, blah, blah. But this movie doesn't feel romantic in the same way I would say my favorite romantic movies do. But a lot of times, if a movie is centered around romance or that's part of the element, like rom-coms, when I see a couple in a movie, I like to ask if they make sense in a realistic setting. While there are some things that seem super romantic or funny in rom-coms, in real life they don't always feel that way. If someone came to your house unannounced and you didn't give them your address, you definitely feel unsettled, especially if you're a woman. But it's considered a cute little pop-by in romantic comedies. So the first time that Kevin really sees Jane is when she's running out to a cab during a wedding that he's covering for the paper. He notices that she's in a rush, but also he ends up seeing her undress in the cab. So it's no surprise that he takes notice, and later he finds that she's been knocked out over the bouquet toss. But I think the first time that they meet face to face is super important because it's directly related to his role in the story. His larger role in the story is to be the catalyst for a lot of the events that happen, but more so to help her recognize that she sees herself as a caregiver and that she also needs to be cared for. And that's exactly what he's doing the first time they meet. He takes the initiative to make sure that she's okay and that when she wakes up that she's not surrounded by 100 people rushing around, but that she feels fine and that she's not severely concussed. But at this point in the film, it's the first time that you really see anyone showing any concern for Jane or wanting to take care of Jane. And again, I think this movie is less about her romance with him and more about her growth as a character and as a person. Much of the story surrounding Jane is that she's a caregiver. When her mom died at a young age, she began taking care of her young sister while her dad grieved. And at her cousin's wedding, she helped solve a problem the bride had, which made her feel even better about what it means to care for others. So this is kind of how we see more of her becoming a type A personality, being organized and making sure everything goes as planned from here on out. And it's even more apparent in that she felt that this was her calling, not to be a wedding planner, but to be a bridesmaid. See, a wedding planner gets compensated for organizing everything and dealing with picky brides, but a bridesmaid offers support for free. While she does help organize things in the way that a planner might, she doesn't receive compensation other than the feeling of knowing she helped make the day special for her friend. She also offers emotional support in a personal way, contrary to a wedding planner who doesn't necessarily need to be close friends with the bride to be able to plan things. And when I first watched the opening scene, I thought that she meant that she wanted to be a wedding planner, that her calling was to be a wedding planner, and it sort of threw me for a loop because I obviously realized when they showed her at her work that she was not a wedding planner, because I thought this whole time, having only seen the movie a couple times a few years ago, that she was a wedding planner. And it makes her situation almost worse in the sense that if she were a wedding planner, it would make sense that she would have this job that really encompasses her passion, but she's really just an assistant at a job that's not really her passion. Like, the things that she's doing aren't the things she's passionate about in the capacity that weddings are. Not to say that your passion has to be your entire life, but she sort of transfers that energy towards her job, but her transferring that energy makes a lot of the work environment very unbalanced. Either way, the other part of being a caregiver for Jane is that she's also a pushover. And you can be a caregiver and still advocate for your needs. However, I think Jane taking on the mother type of role in her family has led her to view herself in the way society views motherhood. In a sense that someone should care unconditionally and throw themselves on the fire if necessary. So Jane doesn't allow herself to have needs or wants because she doesn't see herself as having agency the way mothers aren't supposed to have agency according to society. And this mentality plays out in every aspect of her life. Being a caretaker for her sister, her friends, as a bridesmaid, and also her boss. And like I said before, because of this mentality, the way Kevin enters her life is that he's a catalyst for many of the things that occur. He ends up getting her planner so he knows where she'll be and when, and this allows him to show up at places not only because he finds her interesting, but also so he can write about her for a story he pitched to his boss. He also sends flowers to Jane's office, but she thinks they're from her boss, George, because there's no card. So later that evening at a party with coworkers, she finally gets the guts to tell George how she feels. But before she can do so, she finds that the flowers weren't from him. She also finds that he's interested in her sister, Tess. And to make the night even worse, Kevin shows up and tells her that the flowers were from him. And at this point, the only other encounters she's had with him have been frustrating, as he's very cynical about love and weddings, whereas she's on the opposite end of the spectrum. So obviously, it's frustrating that the one person taking notice of her is the man she feels is antagonizing her. It's very much like the idea of a boy pulling on a girl's pigtails. From the outside, it may look like the boy has a crush on the girl, but as the girl, this boy is being mean to you and only wants to see you suffer, and it's not funny. It seems a lot of Kevin's perspective is him trying to understand Jane in, like, the meanest possible way. It's easy as a viewer to see why Jane is the way she is, but for someone just meeting her, he's interested in knowing the real reason why she spends so much time helping others when it almost never benefits her. He even asks her out, and at that point, it seems like he's only doing it to get info for his story and not because he's genuinely interested in dating her. But she says no until Tess and George get engaged. Then she decides to meet with Kevin to talk about her disdain for helping Tess because she knows Tess will want her to do everything in the planning of the wedding. And of course, Kevin being an outsider, he makes light of this by trying to tell Jane that she can just set boundaries and say no to her sister, even though Jane has always felt obligated to take care of things when Tess doesn't want to. Later, when the wedding is creeping closer, Jane finds out that Kevin is actually the one who writes her favorite section of the paper, and he's doing the article on her sister's wedding. She obviously feels upset and betrayed about this because he essentially lied to her about his intentions, and because it feels like all the heartfelt writing she loved and upheld is pretty much a sham. Which feels justified. It's like meeting your favorite celebrity and thinking they're super cool, and then they turn out to be a jerk. So it's understandable why she might have some disdain for this man, because, like, her first impressions were not great of him. He approached her and was talking about how much he hates weddings, and, you know, you can meet someone and they seem to be caring, and it's like, oh, you seem like a nice person, but when you start to talk more, I really don't like anything you have to say. And then, of course, as she starts to kind of get to know him and try to let him in, she's like, okay, I'll hang out with you because I need someone sort of outside of my circle to talk to. Like, I need someone to vent to. And then finding out that he's actually more connected to her in this situation, again, I would be very frustrated and probably not want to talk to him that much. But he still tries to get close to her when he shows up to her door wanting to interview her. Then he finds her closet full of dresses, and I think this is when he starts to get a better picture of the kind of person she is. Her love for weddings and her friends makes things start to make sense in that she's keeping all of these dresses for their memories and for the feeling that comes along with that. And of course, this is when we get our montage of her trying on all 27 dresses, and they're having a great time, and she's recounting some of these memories and essentially hanging out with him. But later, when things settle down and she starts to share more of her deeper feelings about love and sort of her desires, he ruins the moment by taking a flash photo of her. And I can't say that this wouldn't happen in real life, because Lord knows how many times I've been in a moment where it seems romantic and all of a sudden I like burp in their face or something, like just ruining the moment. But this one feels specifically so sad, because she really was trying to open up in a way that I don't think she realized she was. However, Kevin still tags along for the next activity when they scan things for the registry. And again, you can start to see how Jane dreams of life where each item will hold memories of love between family, but Kevin always swoops in to say the most cynical thing about the items. And I think in him doing this, he's trying to sort of bring her down to reality, because in reality, all the things she talks about are a bit far off from where she currently is, even though they're not impossible things. But she'll never view her desires as far off, because she's witnessed love and weddings, and she has seen that romance for others and wants it for herself. But eventually, she gets tired of him bringing her down, so she posits that he has had a tragic past with love. And he does the same thing in telling her that she does everything with others, so she doesn't have to focus on how boring and empty her life is. And of course, this strikes something in her, so she hits the nail right on the head when she says that she guesses someone left him, and she's correct. And I think this is an interesting moment, because this happens a lot in real life, where you'll be talking to someone about something sort of serious, and it's not a serious moment. The moment that they have in this particular scene where they both realize something serious about the other person and about themselves, that this is why I think this, or this is why they are the way that they are, is something that happens a lot in real life, where you're in a very casual situation and something comes up without anyone necessarily meaning to make it serious, and you recognize that it's serious, and then you just try to move on from it. So later, when Jane meets George for a tasting alone, Kevin shows up to realize that Jane is actually in love with George. So later, he confronts her in the car as they're driving from a trip to pick out linens for the wedding. He explains that from his perspective, it seems that part of her hard time with the wedding is not that she has to plan everything, but that her sister is literally marrying the guy that she's in love with. But of course, she denies this, and she ends up running them off the road in frustration. So they get out, and it's super rainy outside, and so they decide to find a nearby bar in hopes of getting a tow truck, but it's clear they won't be leaving anytime soon, so they sit down and they begin to drink. And a few drinks in, they're feeling buzzed, maybe even close to drunk, and Kevin shares that his favorite part of weddings is looking at the groom when the bride walks out, and Jane realizes that they do have one thing in common, because that's her favorite part too. And this is, again, another moment of them bonding, where they get super drunk and they start singing Benny and the Jets with the whole bar, and they're dancing around and singing really loud for a few hours, it seems like. So when he helps her down off the bar later, he admits that he actually is a softie for weddings, and that he cried at one of the weddings that he wrote about. They end up kissing, and this leads them to do it in the car, and the next morning, it's clear Jane is still trying to process her feelings about Kevin, because she's usually so responsible in doing things by the book. It's kind of assumed that she would rather have a romance before she does the deed with someone, but at the same time, she also thinks about her new knowledge of Kevin. Like, you can tell that she's really thinking hard on this and trying to process this experience, because she's realizing that he's not cynical because he's been hurt, but that he's cynical to detach himself from the pain weddings stir up for him. And at this point, he's somewhat numb, but it seems like he's starting to get in touch more with his feelings as he's around her. But unfortunately, it all goes out the window when she finds out he wrote an article about her that ended up on the front page of the section. It's both extremely personal, but also paints her sister in a bad light. Betrayed again, she leaves to return to her apartment where Tess is upset with her, but Jane is too busy recounting the time she'd spent with Kevin, and I'm assuming that she's wondering if any of it was a real connection or if it was just a ruse in order for him to write an article. This is also another point in which her relationships begin to shift. At work, Kevin keeps calling, wanting to explain, but she doesn't respond. George inquires about how she feels for what seems like the first time that he's personally interested in her personal feelings. And at a dress fitting, Jane discovers Tess has taken apart their mother's dress, the one that Jane wanted to wear at her own wedding so badly. This is the last straw for Jane, and she tells Tess to tell George the truth or she will. Part of Jane's disdain for the relationship is that Tess has been lying to George since the start. She lied about enjoying the outdoors and hiking and animals like their dog and being a vegetarian. Which, a lot of these things you don't necessarily need to have in common with people to be able to be a good partner. I think it's interesting, though, that this is so common that we have these enemies to lovers tropes, but people still think that you need to have everything in common in order to be a good partner to someone, which is just not true. My parents have been together for years, and there's a lot that they don't have in common. However, they do share the same personal values and morals, so things work. They enjoy each other's presence, and they enjoy learning new things and trying new things because of the other person. And I think that's part of the important part, is that even if Tess doesn't like the outdoors or hiking, or doesn't like animals and enjoys eating meat, those things aren't necessarily deal breakers. I think if she was willing to give his interests a try, or to consider his perspective on things, or essentially not be rude about being a vegetarian, I don't know. It depends on why someone's a vegetarian, if they do it because they dislike meat or because they want to protect animals. But either way, it's like, it's not really your moral obligation to like be like your partner. Either way, I think it's obvious that Tess would lie about something like that because she does seem to be a bit conceited in the sense that she doesn't have an understanding of how to attract people without being exactly like them. So at the rehearsal dinner, Jane is clearly unhinged. She's unhinged. She plays a slideshow exposing Tess because Tess didn't tell George the truth, but it's very clear that this was the wrong move. She obviously should have confronted them in private instead of embarrassing them in front of their friends and family. But George calls off the wedding with Tess, and Tess is obviously upset. And even Jane's, I guess, morally objectionable friend tells her that what she did wasn't right, even from her perspective. And outside, Kevin confronts Jane, saying that the reason he showed up was to be there for her. He knew the night would be hard for her, and he wanted to offer support. But she's still angry with him, feeling that her life has imploded and he's just not helping. He ends up giving her a digital planner he got for her, saying she deserves more than what she's been settling for and that she deserves to be taken care of for a change, but that if she doesn't want him around, he'll leave her alone for good. Which I think is a great moment of boundaries, where he says, hey, you clearly don't want me around. I messed up, and I understand if you can't forgive me, so I'll leave you alone. Like, I will move on, and I won't bother you anymore. I think this idea that you need to, like, keep chasing after someone if you think they're the one, or if you have a crush on them, or if you like them in any capacity, is really bad for portraying how boundaries should work. Granted, this guy oversteps her boundaries consistently throughout the story by showing up in places where she doesn't want him or she doesn't want to interact with him is, like, wrong. You shouldn't do that. Also, in this moment, it's a good portrayal of boundaries in that he says, okay, I understand. I did something wrong and you don't want to see me. And if you don't want to talk this through, that's fine. I'll leave you alone. That's good boundaries, is respecting someone's boundaries. Finally, things come to a head when her dad gets both of the girls together to work things out, and Tess explains that she never asked Jane to be a mother and that she knows that she gets a lot of what she wants. Like, Tess is aware that she essentially has pretty privilege and that's why a lot of things work out for her. But she also mentions that she does face hardship, that her life isn't perfect. She doesn't have everything that she wants, and that she was actually trying to act like Jane in lying to George. She was trying to be the perfect girl for George. And I think this is a great moment for Jane to sort of have a little more perspective on her sister, because I think even as close as you are to your sibling, watching them grow up or being around when they grow up, you don't always have a full perspective of their life, especially after they become an adult. I love my brother, and I would say that I'm fairly close to my brother, but I don't know everything that's going on in his life all of the time. So I'm obviously going to have a perspective on his life that maybe doesn't fully encompass who he is as a person. And I think in this moment, Jane finally gets to view her sister as a full and rounded individual instead of just the perspective that she has on her that can be sort of flat and or one-dimensional. She also gets called into work by George only to realize that he's never going to see her as more than an assistant. She decides to quit because she has this realization and she also has a sense of agency about her at this point. And he ends up kissing her, but they discover they don't feel anything for each other. They even kiss a second time and they're like, I felt nothing for you. But a notification from the planner that Kevin gave her plays Benny and the Jets, and obviously this is the moment that she realizes she did feel something for Kevin. So she finds him at a wedding and confesses her feelings in front of everyone. And of course, he feels the same way, they kiss, and we transition to a year later at their wedding. And again, I think this is another great moment in the story where instead of them just getting married like a week later or him proposing right there and it just being this insane, like, you don't know each other, you've only known each other for maybe a month, is insane. So I like that they don't just immediately get married at the end of the movie, but it is fun to see that they did get married in the end. And I think the thing that specifically is missing from this movie is the idea of marriage after the wedding. There's a lot of focus on the relationship before the wedding and the wedding itself in this movie and the implications of a wedding, but they don't ever really discuss or put into perspective what it means to be in a relationship after a wedding. The only relationship that we really know about that someone has been married is their mother and father, and their mother is clearly gone, so we don't know anything more than they were just really in love. And even more so, we don't really learn enough about Kevin's personal life to know if he'd actually be a good fit for Jane at this point. While he did help her learn an important lesson about herself and about life, it doesn't really negate that she would be perfectly fine as an independent person. I think in many ways her character growth is more important than the relationship she ends up with in the end. Because someone like Kevin can definitely come into your life and teach you new things about yourself and give you a new perspective on your life and the people in your life, and you still not be the one for them, or they be the one for you. And that's what a lot of relationships, especially in early life, tend to be, is that they change your perspective on the things in your life in some aspect, but they don't necessarily need to be the person who completes your life or is the person that you marry. I think the movie would have been just fine without seeing the ending of her getting married to this guy, simply because I think the lesson that she learned about herself was more important than the relationship and being married than anything else. I mean, obviously we have the iconic shot of them panning out and you see that she has all 27 of the women that she was a bridesmaid for as her bridesmaids, and it's just like an insane number of people standing there, but it's like so unnecessary. And I wouldn't necessarily say that this relationship that they have is toxic or problematic in any particular way, because there's just not enough information about them both as individuals, but also them in a relationship enough for me to say one way or the other. And sort of to compare, if you've seen the movie Purple Hearts or if you know what it's about, then you know that there's like a clear problem with that relationship. Like the very nature of it doesn't make any sense. And it's very clear from the start that they have different moral standings, different values, etc. So their relationship will never make sense unless one of them genuinely changes their values over time. But most of the time, you shouldn't enter a relationship if it's a I can fix them situation. If you find out that they desperately want children at the beginning of the relationship and you don't, maybe don't count on them changing their mind. So yeah, I think they're a cute couple, but I think the tension between them is more fun than anything else, that he's sort of, I won't say antagonizes her. I think it's just fun that he antagonizes her throughout the whole movie and also acts as sort of a catalyst, as well as the wedding that's taking place. I think both of those things in combination are what act as catalysts for her to grow as a person and to realize that being a caregiver can be, it's fine that she wants to take care of people, but also that she needs to learn to let people take care of her and to have agency in her own life and be more assertive with her needs and wants, because those are important too. So I don't know. I love this movie. I think it's a great movie, and there's a lot about it that I find interesting, because I do love like a neat little rom-com scenario where you're like, what? But at the same time, I can't really say anything too much about their relationship because I just don't have enough information. But I do feel weird that this is considered a rom-com when there's like no romance happening anywhere with the main character. Like, to me, this is just a movie about a woman realizing that she doesn't have to take care of everything herself. I think labeling this as like a rom-com is like okay, but not in relation to the main character, because the main character is very much removed from the rom-com aspect of the movie in a sense. So while her romance technically falls under enemies to lovers, I think that this movie leans more in the direction of just being a girly film about life and love, and not really her romance in particular. A lot of this is just that I hadn't watched the movie in years, so rewatching it was very interesting to sort of rediscover and have a different perspective on this type of movie and what goes on in the plot, especially given that I'm pretty sure the last time I watched this movie, I was like a teenager or a kid, and it was before I had pretty much been in any relationship. So I'm sure that I thought this movie was very fun and exciting and romantic, but now as an adult, seeing what this movie is really about, I actually appreciate it a lot more in knowing that it's about Jane and not about Jane and so-and-so. Like, it's about Jane, and I love that for her. Anyway, you'll have to let me know what you think about this movie and about this kind of perspective in it being a rom-com but not really having the rom part of it. Either way, this was an interesting movie to sort of start off my little February romance series. So with that, keep watching movies, and I'll see you guys next week.